Good evening and welcome. Thank you for coming to our last of three preschool parent workshops. Before I introduce our speaker for tonight, we are going to have a quick presentation. I'd like to invite up Brian Moore. He is the chairman of our school board for Fauquier County Public Schools. Come on up.
Good evening, everybody. A child's school readiness is dependent on their opportunities and experiences in preschool and the community. And Fauquier County is embracing this knowledge and has worked with multiple agencies this year to support preschoolers within our community. Tonight, Fauquier County Public Schools would like to recognize two of those partners, St. James Episcopal Church and school, as well as the Head Start program. So, in just a moment, let me recognize these folks. We're going to start with St. James Episcopal Church and school. Father Ben, Eileen Bergwin, and Scott Christian from the Learning Starts Early Fund are here on behalf of St. James Episcopal Church and school. Thank you so much. Several other volunteers are around the building or in the back serving in child care rooms right now. St. James Episcopal Church and School is supporting our preschool program in multiple ways. They did a supply drive this past fall. They sponsored a race this fall and donated the proceeds to purchase a translation system that our Spanish-speaking families are using tonight. They've assisted in the organizing and implementation of our entire parent workshop series. And they've raised community awareness on the importance of preschool education. Father Ben, Eileen, Dr. McGill, and Scott, on behalf of the county school system, the school board, and Dr. Ben, I'd like to thank you for supporting our preschool program and making a difference in the lives of all of our preschool students. And we have a plaque here for St. James Episcopal Church and School to thank you so much for all you've done. It's really thank you so much. In addition, I have the distinct honor of honoring the Head Start program, specifically Ms. Pat Washington. Ms. Washington has worked tirelessly over the years to advocate and support preschoolers in our community. And your reputation precedes you. You've been an absolute stalwart of our community. Thank you for all your enormous contributions. Our partnership is vital to making this program successful. Thank you for all that you've done for Fauquier County, students, our community. I also have a quick letter to read on behalf of the school board and the superintendent here. Dear Ms. Washington, on behalf of the Fauquier County Public Schools, I'd like to thank you and the Head Start staff for your collaboration in the preschool parent workshop series this year. Due to Head Start's assistance in interpretations, translations, and child care, all families, regardless of home language or family need, were able to access each workshop. Attendance was remarkable, and feedback received was overwhelmingly positive. Your commitment and dedication to making a difference in our community is greatly appreciated. Thank you for working for Fauquier County Public Schools to improve the school readiness of our preschool population and setting them up for future school success. Thank you so very much. Just in closing, on behalf of the school board, we put our stamp on what we approve and what we see as valuable every year in the budget. And what we fund. And to the maximum extent that we can draw down funds in this county for preschool programs, we do so through Fauquier County Public Schools. And next year, I'm very happy to tell you, I think it's an absolute priority in our school division that we continue to invest even more in these preschool initiatives. We see the success already and throughout our community. It's such a way to invest in the future of our children and our future students. So, thank you for everybody here tonight. Kristen McCall, thank you very much. You've been an absolute superstar in the past couple of years. Thank you very much.
Let's just give a quick round of applause to Brian Gore for coming tonight. And now for the real reason you came, I'd like to introduce our presenter for the night, Kara Thompson. Kara has been with Fauquier County Public Schools for 13 years as a physical therapist. And prior to coming to Fauquier County Public Schools, she was a pediatric physical therapist in private practice for 17 years. I can see they're doing the math right now. I think you're in for a real treat. She's got all kinds of fun things to share with you. And those of you who have Fauquier County Public School children or Head Start children, balls that she's going to be modeling tonight will be going home with your children in the next couple of days. Those of you who do not have Fauquier County Public School children but have preschoolers, I do have balls, but logistically it was a little bit tricky to get them blown up and here in the quantity that I had to do. So if you would like to take one and blow up at your convenience, I have some to give away at the end of the workshop. Without further ado, Kara.
Do you want to inhale that?
Yeah, that would be easier.
Thank you, guys. For those of you that don't know, you're shocked from the high heels. It's because I'm told not to walk away from the podium, so I figure if I walk away, I'll trip and fall, so it'll keep you here. Wanted to tell you guys real quick the gross motor stuff. It's a lot of fun. It's going to go kind of fast. It will be organized in a way that should make sense. But if you do have questions to clarify what I'm saying right at that moment, feel free to ask. And also feel free to tell me when I'm about to trip over something and I'll walk away. Let's see if I can make this work. Let's keep going.
I dated myself with the music. Do we have any speakers?
It's Rocky anyway. These are kids from Bradley, if any of your parents happen to recognize them from the preschool program. Spinning, vestibular, my favorite. Kids can never get enough of this, by the way. Bradley, this is the thing, the preschool rather likes to call it, that's para playtime, not playtime that you get to do when you're not with me, but they're rolling down the hills and stuff. Okay, so what is gross motor? Gross motor is any of the skills that require the large muscles of the body. Can y'all hear me? I'm pretty loud, but I can, if you can't hear me, just come let me know. But they're the large muscles of the body. They're for walking, running, sitting, falling, throwing, catching, balance, vestibular, any of the other activities. we're gonna go through the different parts of gross motor development. So we're gonna first talk about normal development. And I do normal development starting at 12 months because this is a preschool, preschool thing, but I do drop back on development a little bit, a lot younger with some of the other kids when we get there. But at 12 months, you're pulling to stand, you're walking around furniture, you may be walking and standing alone. At 18 months, you're walking alone, you may be walking up steps, you could be running. At 2 years, you're up on your tiptoes, you can kick the ball, you start to run. You climb up and down furniture without help. You walk up and down stairs holding on. You throw a ball overhand. At a much younger age, you do a tossing ball. At 3 years, you climb, you run, you pedal a trike or a three-wheel bike. You walk up and down stairs, alternating your feet instead of up. It's a alternate. At 4, you're going to hop, you're going to stand on 1 foot, a couple of seconds, you can catch and bounce a ball. Most of the time, gallop, a lot of 4-year-olds can hop more than a couple of seconds. And then at 5, you're going to be on the 1 foot for 10 seconds or longer. You should be able to hop many times on your foot. You may be able to skip. You can do a somersault. Some kids don't get skipping until later. You can do a somersault, you swing, you climb, you start to jump rope, you walk on a balance beam or a line or something. I probably should get the, I don't know, I think I switched it. Why do some kids develop at slower rates now compared to 30 years ago? And it's actually kind of 25 years ago. There are actually very important things that the pediatricians are aware of, but is not necessarily getting the attention that it should be. The reason we're developing at a slower rate is actually a medical breakthrough that is a good thing, but it's causing slower rates. Back in 92, the Back to Sleep Initiative was founded, and it was because they found strong studies that supported that SIDS, sudden infant death syndrome, was caused by kids sleeping on their stomach, or more than likely with kids sleeping on their stomach. So the fact that they don't have tummy time is resulted in delayed and a lot of delayed motor skills. Now, it's nowadays, it moved on from there. 92, it used to be that you could prop your baby on the side, either side, or put different stuff. That's all gone. You're not supposed to have anything in that baby's crib nowadays. Nothing. You're not even, I think they don't even want blankets in there anymore. They want you to have the onesie zip up and stuff. So you're not supposed to have any bolsters or anything in the baby's crib because of the, not just SIDS, but suffocation and all of that. So skills got slower developed because of that. And I'll get into why that caused the slower development in just a little bit. A huge one is sitting in carriers and infant seats and sling seats. And the Physical Therapy Association and some others and some doctors, they call it container baby syndrome, which sounds funny. And it actually, it's not neglect. Everybody's like, oh my God, it's caused from the fact that your baby is in a carrier, and then you take them out of the carrier, and you put them in a swing, and then you take them out of the swing, and then you put them in the crib, and you take them out of the crib, and you put them in the swing, and then you take them out of the swing, and then you put them in the back into a carrier, and you go somewhere else. And they stay in the carrier all the time. Now, how it gets even worse and worse is because babies now have to be on their back, there's something that did increase. It's called polyp. Babies on their back were getting worse and worse screaming episodes up until 3 months. So parents found out, oh, I put them in my container, and the baby's comfortable. So now babies are in their container all the time because they're sleeping in the containers, because their head's up. You can lift your baby's head up with the bed without putting them in the container. But, okay, that happens. Now, 3 months down the road, suddenly you're playing with your baby, and they don't tolerate anything. They don't tolerate you holding them, they don't tolerate being turned around, they don't tolerate them being unclenched your stomach, they don't tolerate anything because their sensory system is now in the container. So examples of what happens, what we call container syndrome. We see the flattening of the head, which happens almost 100% of the time for babies nowadays. You get the flattening of the head. You get torticollis, get a tightening of the neck muscles that goes down into here. Then you also can see delayed muscle development. You see sensory problems, delayed cognitive development, and facial asymmetry. Why would being in a container cause all of that? Why? Well, your sensory system is contained. You don't have any of the experiences that back in the day when we had no containers, there were no. If you had a car seat, it was so darn heavy, you weren't carrying that puppy around. There's with a baby in it, the baby instead just slung over your shoulder or over your lap or held with their face down and cradled in your hands. And these babies weren't staying in a container. You have a container to put them on. You're putting a rug out and chairs around them so that the baby's down on the floor. So you didn't have any of those. So when a baby is in a container, they don't get the sensory input that you get when you're being carried. You don't get the vestibular, which we'll talk about more, but you don't get the rotary or vestibular foot input, because when you're in a container, even if you're swinging the seat back and forth, it's a linear movement, and it goes back up behind the head, and there's full support. When you're sitting there in the container, where's your vision? Oh, wait, you're an infant. Now where's your vision? Because gravity, I'm sorry, babies don't have head support, and even with those heads up things, gravity just can't hold their heads up. And now their vision is here. It's sideways and it's here. They're visually processing all the time in that position. So you've got sensory, you've got vision. Your hearing is impacted by the fact that you've got these heads up of your stuff. If you stood with the tunnel behind you and listened to somebody talk, it's a different thing you hear. It's a different process. You're not hearing the same thing. So you've got the flat head, the sensory problem. Why delay cognitive development? Well, because when you're a baby, the way you learn is by all of the input of the senses and everything around you. If you don't get that input, that visual input, that sensory input, the holding, the carrying, you can't make sense of your world. And if you can't make sense of your world, you can't learn. And we get a lot more into that later. I'm sure you're all very excited about that. So we've got the container baby, and then, my favorite, we don't go outside anymore at all. That's why we're delayed. I see 6-month-olds that are better with an iPhone than I am. They don't get anything. Everything visually is restrained down into a computer or something else. We're not getting up, we're not walking around, we're not sensing our environment. We're instead using some bizarre mechanism of visual input of somebody else having that existence instead of you. And that's, of course, and everybody knows that computer games technology is the best and worst thing that's ever happened. And I'm one of the worst with it. All right, so did you
move? It still didn't move. Did I turn it off? All right, let's see if it works now.
I'll look at it if it doesn't work. All right, so why is it important to develop motor skills? My kid's not going to be an athlete. Who cares? So, gross motor. Let me try it. No, you're going to have to do it. Just hit it once, Lisa. All right. So, gross motor and core strength delays cause fine motor delays. All right. Next. Gross motor skills linked to the health and well-being of the child.
Oh, I only did it once. I swear.
Back.
Oh, you press it
now.
Okay.
It's not running better.
Where are we? Back further?
Yep.
I'm going to stop here.
Yep.
So it's good?
Yeah, that's good. All right, so Gross motor and vestibular play directly impact the child's sensory system and visual system. So if you don't get that, the vision doesn't, you don't progress visually, and your sensory system does not progress. And then gross motor and coordination skills are linked to cognitive development. So that's why gross motor matters. It's always been a huge proponent, but it might be good for them. All right, next. So how do we're going to take them one by one. How do gross motor skills impact fine motor? And if y'all went to Lisa's one that she gave, you'd probably get a lot of this. Without the core strength and balance that allows you to function and hold your body in, it's, as they say, stability before mobility. I can't do this if this is like that. So you have to get the mobility. So you, if you don't have the stability before mobility, next, you struggle with feeding, you struggle with next, dressing, you struggle with playing with toys and manipulatives, you struggle with coloring and writing, and you struggle with sitting in a chair at school, which is big. And we see that a lot now. Poor writing and very low tone kids. All right, so the next thing is, so how does gross motor skills get the health and well-being and behavior? All right, physical activity releases the good feeling chemicals in the brain. If any of you are runners, you know that. It increases the oxygen and the glucose in the brain. That's the brain food. That helps you with concentration and memory. Physical activity gets rid of stress. It regulates moods. And most of all, and not least of all, it helps with weight loss. And that's important. But physical activity can be the best thing, the most addictive thing, which I'm not addicted to, but I heard it was really addicting if you're a good runner. Anyway, didn't work for me. Then vestibular. First of all, what is vestibular? I keep saying what vestibular is. Vestibular is any activity that activates the part of the brain that controls balance in your inner ear. It includes swinging, you can just keep pushing, jumping, spinning, sliding, is all of the vestibular stuff. Who cares what vestibular play is? Well, I'll tell you why vestibular play is important. Delays. Delays and problems are linked to attention disorders, huge ADHD, attention disorders, delays in language, and delays in auditory and visual processing. So if you have a poor vestibular system, almost, nothing's absolute, but there's a more, much more likelihood that you're going to see delays in those areas. All right. If we do gross motor activities, does it make your child smarter?
What?
Well, yeah, that's my idea. Always said that. Nobody wants to listen. All right, so studies show that the part of the brain used for hard and challenging motor tasks are the same parts used for sequencing and solving academic problems. For any of you guys that are academia, you ever heard of executive functioning? That's a buzzword. Everybody likes to go, ooh, executive functioning. It links hugely to what we call executive functioning. So executive functioning, for lack of a better way, and you might have a way to explain it better than me, it's the ability to take everything that you've learned and know and pull it together to make a thought process that makes sense. To, you may hear over here that the political guy does this, and you hear over there, and your ability is to not listen to just him. You take everybody's in and is able to assimilate it in a framework. That's executive functioning, and that is something some of our kids, a lot of our kids, are seriously lacking. Well, physical work has been linked to executive functioning. Where was I? Of crawling and cross movements are linked to reading and visual processing. Crawling alone, parents are like, oh, he walked. I'm like, shut him down. Make him crawl, or at least do climbing and stuff like that. But crawling is related to being able to process from left to right, visually track from left to right. Any of the kind of the visual cross movements have been linked to the crawling, to visual tracking. So throwing and catching are related to math and reasoning skills, which explains me. I'm very poor at math, and I work with kids because I'm so bad at throwing stuff. I can throw to a four-year-old. But I'll dodge it if you throw it, if an adult throws it at me. Math and reasoning skills. Motor skills can be predictive of future performance. Are you with me? So we seem to have a good job. Next slide. The news study shows it is never too late to initiate new learning or gross motor skills to get benefit in all areas. It's never too late. Even now, and as an adult, it is never too late. The relationship between learning and movement keeps throughout life. So you gotta keep on moving. So you can come past you. Yep, there you go.
Got it.
Okay. All right, let's move on. All right, so what can I do to help gross motor development? This is the fun stuff. Oh, yes. To talk about the actual flinging of a ball should be seen in about 9 months. As soon as you have them sitting up in a is sitting up in a high chair, almost all babies 9 to 10 months will have that game. They'll toss it down. No, that is what we consider that gross motor, but it is very much linked to fine motor because it's eye-hand coordination. So that those two things kind of go together. So you're talking just not throw, but you're talking catch to you and from you. You should be, most two-year-olds can, what you're looking for a two-year-old is they have the hand out. Okay. That it hits the hand, that may bounce off the hand depending on how far away or how you tossed it to them. If you have it in an arc, it's obviously easier. Now, what a two-year-old or a three-year-old's going to do is they're going to trap it first. They're not going to catch it with their hand. They're going to trap it. And then as you get older and older, you'll be able to see the it going from in to the hands to bigger and smaller balls. The bigger the ball is, the easier it is to catch. The lighter it is, the easier it is to catch. Depending on the size of the child, don't give a ginormous dog a ball, beach ball to a tiny. But the bigger the ball, the easier it is. The brighter the ball, the easier it is to track. And some kids, if they really struggle with throwing and catching, start with bouncing it to them because it's a little easier to track when it's bounced. If they're struggling with the catching part. Let's see. So, what can I do to help gross motor development in the young? Supervised tummy time for infants. I have over there tummy time for infants that if you know anyone pregnant, if you have an infant at home, or you think you're going to have an infant at home, get that handout. It's in both Spanish and English translations, and it gives you wonderful, wonderful tummy time ideas. I think it's the APTA and the Occupational Therapy Associations put it together from a school from Georgia. Supervised tummy time. Everybody asks me, when does that start? The day you bring the baby home. You do not wait till 3 months, but you never do it unsupervised. Never, ever, ever do you do tummy time unsupervised. Tummy time does not have to be the baby flat on its stomach on the thing. Tummy time is you putting the baby up against you or laying with the baby and you kind of got your face in it. Tummy time can start off with 1 to 2 minutes. If you do it 1 to 2 minutes every diaper change, 30 seconds every diaper change, the baby will get used to being on their stomach and they'll learn to like tummy time. If you do tummy time, your baby is going to develop at a much faster rate if you do not do tummy time. A much faster rate because the way our bodies develop is we have extension. Our back muscles and our extensor muscles develop and are stronger much younger. Our flexors, some kids don't get sit-ups until 12. I mean, our flexor muscles are not strong muscles. And we've got a kid flat on his back, and you're expecting them to do what? They can't lift their head up. What are you expecting them to do? Get their hands forward, yeah. You'll see that in about 3 months, and bring their hands to their mouth, and maybe bat at the mobile and stuff. But other than that, that's all they're going to do. So, but if you start tummy time on the day you get the baby home, and it is supervised, 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 I cannot say that enough. You do not leave a baby on their stomach without you being with the baby. But if you get them on their stomach the day they get home, they're not going to be what I typically get with parents. Oh, well, I tried doing tummy time, but they scream their head off. Oh, I started at 3 months. Or my favorite at 3.5 months is I put them on their stomach and then roll right back over. Well, it's not the rolling you and I, but the, not the way the therapist would say is wrong. That's called, ah! When you go, ah, with one arm up. And you flip over, and then after a while, I'm like, ooh, that worked out nicely for me. So, ah, so yeah, when you're screaming your little head off in your stomach, rolling over is really easy. So, start tummy time early, very early, the day you get them home. The day you get them home is when this tummy time starts. All right, so car seats, carriers, strollers, use them for transportation. I know it is so hard to tell a parent of a baby with colic, please don't have them sleep in. It is so hard because it's such a, their life is just terrible with that baby screaming. Instead, talk to the doctor, see if maybe lifting the head of the bed up would be more beneficial or something so that they don't, they're not sleeping in a car seat. I discourage sleeping in like swings and stuff for their naps. But that being said, sometimes let a sleeping baby sleep. there's a time for everything. Just be cognizant of how much time they're spending in a container is what you need to do. Because there are times that you're like, oh my God, they're sleeping. Don't anybody talk, don't anybody move, don't anybody touch them. I get that. Been there, done that. The other thing is playtime on the floor. If you don't think your floor is clean, then put a towel down or put a blanket down. Playtime on the floor because it changes the whole perspective of that infant, especially by about 3 months. Wouldn't you say about 3 months? Because at 3 months, you're going to get a partial forearm up. The head's going to be able to come up. You're going to be able to look around. If you have interesting things in front of them, or better yet, lay in your stomach in front of them, or put a little roll up under them to help get their head up, and then it's a whole new world, baby, when you're down on your stomach and things are up in there. So do the playtime on the floor. Now, say for us at roughhousing, this is kind of funny, because she did the translation for me, and she was like, I'm not sure what roughhousing is, and I'm like, ooh, I'm not sure if that was a good choice of words. Don't throw your kid against the wall. I mean, like, this is this is, and I did say once head and body control are established. This too, safe roughhousing. So many times, once a baby gets a little bit of head control, even with your 3 month old and you're holding your head, do a little woo, swing and spin and give them the experience. Don't freak them out. If they go into then you might have triggered a primitive reflex. You might not want to do that. But don't do some safe swinging and moving so that they can experience the world and their vestibular system in different ways. And you can do that as soon as you feel comfortable with. Now, if you ever see physical therapists or occupational therapists with infants, you would be probably horrified because people like have their face ripped in a hand and we're walking around with them halfway upside down in a football hole going, what's going on? And I'm like, oh, should you have a baby like that? He's experiencing upside down time. So just make sure it's safe. Make sure that what you do, the baby's developmentally ready for it. Let's like not protect the head when they have no head control and spin around. It's probably not a good idea. The other thing is access to push toys, drive toys, and balls. The push toys do not have to be. Everybody thinks that you have to buy the expensive push toys. Some of the best push toys are chairs. Some of the best, you don't have to have the most expensive thing for your child to experience standing up and pushing things around. It could be an ottoman. It could be, there are a lot of things that become push toys. Ride toys, I don't mean the Barbie car that's electric, although that is kind of good. The OT might like it. And the sitting balance, if you've got it, I mean, there might be good visual stuff. But I mean, right where they sit on and they push with their feet. Any of that kind of stuff. And I think those are held in garage sales and stuff all over the place. You should be able to find some of that stuff fairly cheap. Balls are important. And trucks. And anything where you're doing one hand down and you're crawling with one hand and you're pushing the truck with the other. Any of the things that require them to move and activate rather than just sit and act. You want them to be able to have to get to it. You know, in tummy time, at 6 months, you want them to have to put it around in a circle to get all of the toys. Not everything should be put on a tray right in front of them, easily accessible. You need to work for it. And the next thing is gross motor activities. Now, I believe it goes from there to a video. I think you have to click to start the video. And this is going to show you, I wasn't sure how it.
I got that. Which one?
And these are balloon activities. I'm actually going to come back to those, and I don't need this. These things, the pictures, go to the video, we're going to show that, and then I'm actually going to do demonstrations of this up there. These are just so that you have pictures of what to do, because you won't have the video on. Yep. It should be the next one.
Nope.
It did not show up.
I will find it.
There.
This one.
And did you click it again?
Let me try to click it here. Wait, you're not on it now.
Go back.
I have one. Okay, there's your video. Let's go and escape. For sure. Yep.
There it is.
Yep.
All right, so.
To the arrow.
Down here, look.
Yeah. Okay. So do it. Can you make a purple screen there? No.
Let's make this.
Are you okay?
Can y'all see that? All right, so this is again Bradley. I'm going to talk through some of these as they do it. So the balloon. Love me a balloon. Dollar store. There is nothing up here except for one thing that is not from the dollar store. Nothing up here that's not from the dollar store. These, which all of you are going to get, are from the dollar store, but they were only $2.50, I think, or something like that. The balloon, if you could see this, that's reaction time. Can you pause that and go back a little bit? Let me talk about it.
I'm trying.
Let me see.
Hold on. There we go. Hold on, guys. I'm going to try. I'm going to see if I can't.
Insert. I need this to go to.
There we go. That's what I want. I'm going to say. Okay. Automatically. And then I'm going to go back a slide right before it. Ooh, that was the first one. And then, where to go? Here. Okay. So the balloon. Starting this over, people. All right, so the balloon. Use it. The balloon is the best thing in the world. You're batting it up using your hands. You're having to track the balloon. This is dropping different size balloons and having the kids catch it. The smaller the balloon, the harder it is to catch. And kids love this stuff. And the balloon is the cheapest thing you could ever get. You get a huge pack of them. And if you have small, small kids, watch out because it is a choke hazard, huge choke hazard.
But you could also put it on, this is a dollar store bat that you could put it on with. Have them bat it up. I wasn't actually planning on that, but I happened to was videotaping and I'm like, okay, that's awesome. In vestibular, that's just awesome. Any of that is totally awesome. The ball. This is bouncing without the base. Noodle, ball base. $1. You've got a stable kid and he's sitting on the ball. Bouncing on the ball, that's them taking their noses and trying to make the ball go forward while crawling. They didn't do it very successfully. This is trying to roll over on your stomach on a ball. Balls are just awesome things. You can't, there's so much you can do with a ball. Sit and stabilize, sit on a bigger ball, do your homework. I recommend balls for bigger kids too, much bigger kids. The thick balls, do them. The catching, the throwing, that's kind of the obvious things with balls. It's not always that easy. Now, my next favorite thing ever is a racket. For the younger kids, you can go like to the dollar store and get these paddles, just take these things off. Or, down these, how awesome are these? Glass waters, $2, baby. These are awesome. Doing anything with the balloon, just remember the smaller the balloon, the weightier it is. The bigger the balloon, the heftier it is. For kids that struggle with catching and throwing, this punch balloon is awesome. And that's balancing anything. And they made this game up, by the way. Totally made that. I was like, awesome. And this is when we leave. When we leave the gym, we do a jumping onto the bubbles. There's nothing better than the hot bubbles.
Oh, you jumped over. Wow.
This is crab crawling. This Lily crab crawling. Now, what's interesting, Lily had just is really struggled. She's five. She's struggled to crab crawl. And you'll see, and this is bear crawling. This is a huge one that you really should do a lot of stuff with the kids. Bear crawling and bear crawl races are awesome. She go. This is why Lily struggled with crab crawling and bear crawling. But look at that hopping. That was when she was four. These kids can do what they need to do with whatever their body was given. And it's amazing what these kids can do. So you push them the next limit, but accept what their limits are. The back to your thing, this is called a punch ball. Awesome, as always. It's heavy. So it has more of a trajectory of a ball and is easier to catch, whereas a balloon is harder to catch. Type thing. So if you're really working with a kid with catching, because this drifts to you, it's a lot easier to catch that. Then this one's going to stay more up in the air and is a little bit lighter and stuff. This is a good one to start with catching skills if you're having trouble with the heavier balls. Kicking also, you start stationary and then you progress to having a roll. Most of the kids nowadays just run a running kicket. I play soccer. But you do want to get the coordination movements where the ball is being rolled and then they kick it. Other things, I'm shouting on it. The other things that you need to work on are balance activities. The dollar store has either duct tape or regular tape taped. Intricate lines on the floor, on the grass, or sometimes what I'll use, I bought a sample of this. I use the, what is this called? It's like the
shelf liners.
Yeah, shelf liners or whatever. I'll cut out strips of the shelf liner because it's easy down and easy take up, and then make it wider depending on the balance level of the kid so that they can be more successful. Or I'll make it shorter. And then you have the kid doing sideways on the line, going forward, going backwards. The art of
playing outside is gone. It's really sad. But if you start taking these little things spinning, start taking things outside and start a game with your kids. Start a kickball game. Start everybody take these. Dollar store. Awesome. If any of this kind of stuff, just go around, have them spin, have them do different playing activities. The more you have your kid do, and this is for any parent with an ADHD kid, the worst thing I hear is, I just got 4 hours of homework with Johnny last night. He came home from school and we did 4 hours of homework, and I went, Johnny just spent 7.5 hours at school and he came home and you did 4 hours of homework? Well, no, I let him play video games and I'm outside. Johnny, when he comes home, should be given some gross motor task for 20 minutes. Jumping's big. If you have a little tramp, jumping would be awesome. Get that energy out. Give Johnny some sensory input to keep moving. The video game is the worst. Don't start the video game because there's no way you're going to be able to lead it into your homework. But have Johnny go outside first. Tell him when you get home, you get to play. Because that's a lot. That's a lot. When we have kids at school all day and we expect 4 hours of homework at home, in high school, yeah. But that's a lot. So try to space it out. The other thing.
Is this another slide, please? Is this another slide?
These are on your handout to give you ideas of what to do with the balls. Like, one of my favorites is sitting on the two kids sitting on a ball and then bouncing a ball. As a matter of fact, today I did a session with a couple of kids trying to teach them bounce on, bounce to, so that they were knowing that they're bouncing on the ball and bouncing the ball to you. That's two pretty hard concepts using the same word bounce, but gross motor stuff really is good at doing language-based stuff. But if you have any of your kids are struggling, math, you want to do math, do it doing gross motor. Teach your facts doing math marches. Don't teach your facts going 2 + 2 is, teach your plus 2 + 2 equals 4, now I'm going to minus 1. Then I come to great. Just make cadence calls. Make it fun. Start doing it with jumping. Count jumping up. Counting twos going up the stairs. Counting fours. The older the kids get, the more you incorporate in your preschool and any of your kids the gross motor with it, the more likely they're going to memorize it and learn it. But to expect this just to sit down, and this is the worst thing with our preschoolers, to sit down and just learn. They have you need to make sure they get the multitude of experiences for gross motor that they need to sit down and learn. There any questions or anybody want any suggestions on activities or anything? Do y'all need any more activities?
Am I going to show us what to do with the board?
I love me a hula hoop. There's so many things you can do with a hula hoop. This is the cheap dollar store hula hoop. So these, I usually get about 5 or 6 of them, and then I have the kids do hula hoop races. I can't hula hoop myself, but I have them take the hula hoops and then balance them, and then go across the thing and then race after them and then grab them, or see if they can race after and then grab it with one arm, or race after it and grab it.
Oh,
just did the thing. That's okay.
Did race you crawl when you were a baby? I don't know.
The bigger hula hoops, I work on in, out, over, under. I'll put them on things and then have them pop up, do like Jack in the Box, go in and out. Jumping in and out is a big one, and that's also teaching language when you're doing, especially with the preschoolers, always when you do activities with them, use a lot of language. So that's how you learn language. Oh, are you jumping in? Are you jumping out? Are you jumping up? Are you jumping down? Are you jumping off? Are you putting it in? Are you putting it out? Because another concept that preschoolers have a hard time of is you put a pen in the paper and you say, put the pencil or mark on top of the on top of the bear's head. That's a little different when I say on a paper, mark on top of the bear's head, versus me saying to you, pick your ball up and put it on top of this. It's a visually, it's a different plane, it's a different concept. The on, off, and all of this, but positional stuff are great with gross motor stuff. Math is actually great with gross motor stuff. You want to teach your kids how to learn how to count the stairs, count everything they do. When you come to a sidewalk, walk on the curb of, not if you're on the street. I feel like I have to put a disclaimer on everything. If you're in a sidewalk, have them practice walking on the curb. The feet, the holding it, and then walking backwards, and then walking sideways, and then jumping up the curb, and jumping over the curb, and seeing if they can stand and pirouette on the curb, and do any of that stuff. And then you add language into it. It's awesome. When they get older and understand games and rules, that's when you actually get a lot of cognitive learning. Because when you start doing, okay, we're going to have a game, and these are the rules. You're gonna push this all the way down to that line, and then you're gonna push it back. Or I'm gonna have you kick the ball, and you're gonna run to first base, and then come back. It doesn't have to be a game. There can be rules to anything. And then you can let the kids go. I actually like to do different colored like hoops and stuff, and I'll play a game with okay, jump red, jump green, jump yellow, jump blue. If they're up to four commands, it might be jump yellow, jump blue, and then I say to them, okay, now it's your turn, I'm going to jump, and then have them try to see if they could sequence the jump yellow, jump red, jump green, jump blue. Because a lot of times you don't see where your kids' difficulties are until you try things with them, and then you're like, wow, because he could do this, I thought he could do that. Well, I have a boy I work with that picks up balls, no problem. And then he hits them. And it took a long time for me and the occupational therapist to realize he really doesn't know how to use his two hands together. It looks like he does, but he doesn't. He doesn't use it functionally. He's just getting the ball and then tapping it. He can't do a throw. He can't do a release. He can't do any of that. But in your mind, oh, well, you can do that. No, you have to try and push past the other stuff to see what your kids can do. And there's so many things out. If you just would let your kids outside, please, I'm begging you, don't let your kids stay inside all day. It is the hardest thing ever when you come home from work and you're like, oh, I have to go outside and do something. But if you could go outside and do something with them, I'm telling you, they'll develop better, they'll learn better, they'll feel better, they'll look better. Life will be better. Won't be perfect. Won't work for every kid, but it'll be better. Any other questions? We done? Got balls for anybody? Did they tell you that you got balls? Chris, did you tell them? Yep. So I think that we couldn't roll up 275 of those. I don't know why, but sure do it. So I think they're going home if your kids are at home. They're going home with you in the schools. And if they're not, if you wanted to grab them over there, help yourself. Any other questions?
So the tummy time and the other handout, they're both in English and Spanish.
Yeah, the other one, I don't think I told you what the other handout. The other handout is developmental milestones for 3 to 4 and 4 to 5. They're in Spanish and English. And it's not just gross motor. It'll be cognitive, fine. It'll be the full thing. And on my PowerPoint, if you have a PowerPoint, if you want the milestones for younger and older, there's a web place that you can get it from the CDC. I think it's the CDC. Somebody important. Also, on the back of references, I could have spent 2 hours alone on some of the studies that I found. 2 hours alone on executive functioning and tennis racket skills. Working memory, short-term memory, long-term memory, and gross motor stuff. I didn't do that to you guys, but if you're bored, most of my studies are referenced in the back here. If you're really, really bored, come to me and I'll give you 1,000 more. Anything else? Yeah, oh yes.
Is there any way to name my game
poster? I'm sorry, say that again.
The game poster.
Is there any way to make toddler twisters? Is there any way to make a toddler twister? Oh yeah. You would obviously, depending on the developmental age of the kid. But first you have to assume they know what the hand and the foot and the colors are. But if they don't know the hand and the foot and the colors, you change it to shapes. You literally can get these, the handprints. Yep, the handprints and the footprints. Take this comes in 100 different colors. Take your hand, draw it on there, cut it out. It will actually imprint on the floor so that it's not slippery. And then you do it that way. You wouldn't go right hand, left hand. You wouldn't do that with a toddler, but you would definitely do that. The other thing is the bear walking races, crab walking races. Those are big things that toddlers can start doing that are good. Any other questions? Any other great ideas for gross motor skills? Because, see, I love that. If I got something that's just awesome, Brian, anything to add? No awesomeness? No awesomeness? Nothing? Brian has no awesomeness to add.
I'm just supposed to make sure everybody stays put until Christmas call gets back with final instructions about the ball. So
do you not leave. But you can stand up. Thank you.
Specific things that you use.